Good morning, Star East. How's everybody this morning? Oh, come on. You can do better than that. Good morning, Star East. All right, very good. Turn around and wave to our virtual audience, which is back with us as well. Good morning, virtual audience. Thank you and welcome back. Hope you're having a great day. Everybody have a great day yesterday? Yes. All right. Just a few announcements this morning and reminders, and then we'll move in right into the first keynote of the day. Wanted to just lift up our sponsors again. Chance to go through the expo and talk to all the sponsors, get to play with all the toys. Yeah? Awesome. We have silver sponsors as well there, really full expo this year. Remember to join the TechWell Hub. We see the number of people joining there going up, but what's most important is the conversation, the engagement going up there. So join in, join a channel. Still time to sign up for the Leadership Summit. There is a charge for that, but that'll be happening tomorrow. In parallel with the Women Who Test event. Remember that that's a free event, just a really awesome program that Allison has and the other team members have put together. So if you are still interested in that, still time to sign up. Just go to the help desk for either one of those events. Another thank you for Parasoft, who's sponsoring that event for us, Women Who Test event. Networking events, still time for those. The test lab is still open. Everybody's out there enjoying it. I hear the automation zone is getting some good use. So we'll be announcing the prizes for that at closing this afternoon. So make sure you're out there submitting those good bug reports and test reports. Still time to connect with speakers one-on-one. All you need to do is go up to the TechWell booth and you can sign up if speakers have slots left for the Genius Bar and couch sessions. There are a few of those scheduled today as you see at the bottom of that screen, but don't forget that you can also start your own couch session. Just go up and write something in. We're going to push that out to the application, the mobile app, and you'll be able to hold your own couch session if there's a particular topic that you're interested in. Play the game on the mobile app, scavenger hunt. There'll be big prizes for that scavenger hunt. And don't forget about evaluating the sessions using the mobile app or the physical paper that you have in the session rooms. And then we always appreciate feedback on the overall conference. We've been doing conferences like this, as Allison said, for many decades. And the way that they've gotten to be the level of excellence that they are is feedback from each of you. So you've made them better and better each year. So you can fill out the conference evaluation app, have the opportunity to win an Amazon gift card. We do have an encore session tonight after the last keynote. We're still in the process of understanding who that might be, but we're looking for one of the best returned sessions. And so we'll be revealing that later this afternoon. But make sure you plan in your schedule to stick around for that encore session. Allison, I think we maybe have adult beverages for that. Adult beverages, there you go. Great way to end up the last part of the day. All right, everybody having a good time so far? Awesome, are you ready for the next keynote? I have the privilege of introducing Jason Arbon. He's the CEO at Test.ai, where his mission used to test all the world's apps. Gotta love that, huh? Jason has previously worked on several large-scale products, web search at Google and Bing, web browsers, Chrome and Internet Explorer, tested operating systems such as Windows and Chrome OS, and done crowdsource testing, infrastructure and data at utest.com. He's also co-authored books such as How Google Test Software and App Quality, Secrets of Agile App Teams. Please join me in welcoming one of our innovative leaders in applying AI to software testing, Jason Arbon.
So close. All right, good morning. It's early, so I thought we'd start with a light topic. Topic is the AI testing singularity. So what this is basically the moment when machines will actually do all of the software testing, right? So I basically have an escape plan out the the back curtain at the end of this. So for a quick poll before we start this thing, so how many AI testing bots are out here in the audience? None? The virtual audience? There's a couple hands, all right. How many people here are human? Human testers? All right, there's a few, good. Mike, I think we need the backup slides, actually. So I would like to start every presentation with running code, since I was humiliated once during a presentation at Google. They said speak with code and data, not PowerPoint slides. So what you're looking at here is real AI. We use a combination of classifiers, neural networks, reinforcement learning, and these things are testing apps that I've never seen before. I don't even know about them. Half of them I don't care about and will never use. But AI is actually real, and it's happening, and it's running today. It also likes to take control and show off. Sorry. This is the beginning of the end. We're fighting the robots. One second. It likes to finish its thing, do its pirouette, and then we can move on, maybe. There we go. So, yeah, as Mike said, why do I work on this stuff, and why do I have such a crazy mission statement for the team? It's basically kind of manifest destiny, right? I basically worked at Microsoft back on AI before it was cool. We worked on very large scale neural network training for the search engine Bing. And I worked at Google on personalized web search there for a while. And there we kind of impacted, you know, at one point something people over at Microsoft, 3.5 maybe billion at Google. What I like to do is have wide scale impact, even though it may be bad. I like to have some impact on the planet. At UTest, it was fun because we got test with, and it's applause is here, it's now named applause. But it was like the world's largest test team, so that was pretty fun. We tested like hundreds of apps with 100,000 people around the world signed up. And then I quit there because I'm a professional quitter, and started test.ai, because the only next thing I could possibly do to keep myself entertained is to try to be ambitious and test all the apps for all the people. But the reason I did this is actually not just masochism. It was basically the idea that machine learning is the first technology that will actually help testing, right? Every other technology wave before has been, you know, it's been mobile, it's been cloud. It's basically just been making our lives more complex, larger fragmentation, bigger matrices, and Agile's made our lives a living you-know-what by speeding everything up, so you don't have any time to test. But basically, AI is the first time we have a chance to actually solve the testing problem. So, yeah, I've written some books. This is just so that people believe I know what I'm talking about. Nobody reads books anymore, but they go, oh, he wrote a book. Also for fun, I encourage everyone to do this. So I used to work at Google for a while, and then my manager put me up for promotion, and I was denied promotion, right? The main reason I was denied promotion, I was driving two teams, developers, testers, web search, Chrome. You think I might get a promotion? It was a lower level STE there, and you know what? I didn't have enough code check-ins, right? So I quit, but it's good a few years later to come back and get an A round from Google instead of promotion. It's a lot better way to live life. So I like to quote this guy, smart guy, but he's recently said, testers are professional skeptics, like all good, right? I like to share a lot on LinkedIn and probably overshare, but testers are always skeptical. So what you're about to see, if you're concerned or anxious or have anxiety issues, I recommend you just, it's okay, and take a break in the hallway. And if you're skeptical, that's healthy. You're a professional skeptic, right? But I invite you to think for the next few slides, drop your skepticism a little bit, and just see and believe what's running today. You don't have to believe what's going to happen in the future, but my goal is to make sure that everybody is aware at least of what's happening today and where it's trending. So let's start with this. And again, I always start with people that are not me usually, because no one believes me. Who the heck am I? I'm just a software tester. But this Nick Bostrom's like, you know, these are all, you know, postdoc folks. This guy's at Oxford or something. But he polled a bunch of the AI folks in the field, right? All the top AI researchers. And the net-net of his data is that 10% of them think that AI will be as smart as a human being by the year 2030. Now, you think about, 1 in 10, that's not very likely. If I told you there was a 1 in 10 chance a meteor is going to hit the planet in 2030, you'd be a little bit anxious, right? 50% of them think it's going to happen by 2050, and almost all of them think it's going to happen by the year 2100. Even the nitty, whiny, skeptical, cranky AI researchers think it's going to happen by the end of the century. So it's going to happen. The question is when. A good note is, also surveying these AI researchers, is that most of them think that the AI is going to be probably nice and beneficial to us, net beneficial. It's going to cause a lot of disruption and churn in the near term, but generally people are optimistic. We'll see if they're right. Another book as recently as Max Tegmark's book. Anybody read that one? Life 3.0? No. Highly recommend it. It's super accessible. You don't have to know any math. But he polled even the readers of the book, right? Just casual readers. And they had very similar results. So it seems like no matter whether we poll the AI community or we poll the general public, everyone kind of thinks it's coming. It's coming soon, and it's probably going to not kill us. So this is the way I think about software testers and thinking about AI doing the testing for them. Number one, the first reaction is like, now the world needs me, right? I'm unique, I'm special. Machines can never replace my creativity and my awesomeness, right? But of all people, and I hate to quote, sound like a dork, I've never met the man, but Elon Musk was being interviewed 2 weeks ago by an MIT researcher who focuses on building electronic components in the dashboard to make sure that humans are aware while they're driving, right? To make sure they measure attentiveness. So if they drift off, they're not paying attention, it'll flash at them, wake them up so that they don't run off the road or run into somebody else. So we asked Elon Musk in an interview, he says, like, what do you think of my research, right? And he thinks pretty proud of it. He spent the last 3-4 years of his life focusing on this. And then Musk just told him simply, and a year, 2 years, not interesting. And the guy's like, well, I mean, come on, it's kind of cool, right? And important, safety, it might save lives. But Musk's response was that the AI driving cars will probably be twice as safe as humans within a couple years. So what happens when the AI is twice as safe as you? I know I've totaled 3 cars in my life, right? A couple power poles became my friends, right? The weird thing is all AI has to do, it doesn't have to be perfect, it just has to be better than us, right? Is anybody in the audience fallible? Anybody fallible? Oh, come on. All right, we're not testers here. What conference am I at? All right. So the big thing here is that Elon Musk says that we actually want to keep the driver asleep, right? In 2 years, we'll want them to be sleeping or just not in the front seat. Because if we wake them up and ask them to help, odds are it's going to cause a problem, right? Now, these AIs will still run into things. It will still run into curbs and sidewalks and maybe even kill some people, but it will kill far fewer people. So very soon, it will be our moral obligation to turn over control to the machines because tens of thousands of lives will be saved every year on the roads. So it's a way to think about it. The machines don't have to be perfect. They just have to be better than us, right? Every one of you is the best tester, but think about the person sitting next to you, right? This has to be better than them. So here's another curve. What was that? Did I fall off the stage? Did I pass out and stand back? Anyway. Or are you just really, really slow over here? That's probably the thing. All right. We'll upgrade your CPUs soon. So if you look over here, this is basically a chart of computation over the last century or so. Don't worry about the little details. There's a couple things you should notice, though, right? This is the amount of compute you get for $1,000, right? And what is its equivalent in terms of carbon-based life form gray matter? If you look at it, there's little plots early on in the century, right? That were like, machines were as smart as like an insect or a fly, right? And you look further up the thing, there's a mouse, there's like dogs, there's like developers, and then there's humans. And then at some point you get to multi-humans, right? And eventually we'll be able to simulate the entire, all of humanity's worth of intellect, right? That's if these curves keep going. We don't know that's the case. But everyone's been proven wrong over and over and over again the last 20 years. Every skeptic has been proven wrong. And the reason we don't believe it is that humans can't understand exponential curves, right? We can't understand exponential curves. So we always think about things linearly. So you won't believe. In fact, if you're intelligent and a normal human being, you won't believe this curve will go on forever. But it will. So let's take a look at what AI is doing today. Right, everyone mouths off about, including myself, self-driving cars, and you know they're even doing paintings, and they're beating AlphaGo, and they're playing Atari games now. And this has all happened since I gave my first talk here like 3 years ago on AI and software testing. And everyone thought I was a nut. Apparently, they still think I'm a nut. But a lot has happened since then, right? And a third of the talks here on AI and machine learning today. So it is happening, right? But if you look at these three objects. What they are like a brace. I'm not smart enough. It's some kind of mechanical thing to hold other pieces of metal together, right? I'm not very good with the physical world. But the crazy thing here is, guess who built the thing on the left and designed the thing on the left? A human or a robot? A human, right? Yeah, you're going to be in trouble the rest of your humans. You're right. The thing on the left was the creativity of a human. The other two objects serve the exact same function, but they're lighter. Right? They're stronger, they're stiffer, and actually, to me, they look more creative. Would you everyone generally kind of agree to that? So who's creative, and who's to say that machines can't be creative or generate things? Too often I hear, not to pick on friends of mine, friends I play cards with, but a lot of people say, oh, machines and automation, they can only check stuff, right? This doesn't look like checking. This looks like creating things. This looks like generating value on the planet. This looks like it's beating the pants off of a human, right? And at the end of the day, does it matter if that creativity is sentient, or does it matter that it produces creative-like things that add more value to the planet? So AI is getting smarter and smarter every year. So what happens is I walk around my life. My life is like this now, last 18 months. It's partly my fault because I mouth off about it. But testers send me things on LinkedIn, when I'm walking in the halls here. Now my kids see videos on the internet of dad talking about AI, and they go like, hey dad, like when is the AI gonna take over, right? And like, I'm just driving around, and I'm like, that's pretty deep. And I wanna talk about Moana or some other Disney film. But they wanna talk about the end of life, thanks to machines. So what I did was, I tried to figure out an answer to this question. Everybody asks me, and I usually say one or two things. I go, yeah, it'll eventually take over all of testing, right? They go, when? And I go, it depends, right? So that's why you get, people have heard different answers from me. It won't happen now, and it won't happen soon, but it will eventually happen. But I thought that wasn't a good enough answer, because people keep asking me, and I keep saying, I don't know. What do I know? I spend my whole day trying to get AI robots to recognize what a shopping cart is, right? That's pretty glamorous. And frankly, it's pretty difficult. The AI is not that smart yet. But it can recognize shopping carts, thanks to a lot of time at coffee shops. But what I try to do is take all of testing, all the activities that we do here, all of the kind of topics we've talked about during the week, and I realize that all of them kind of fit into one of three buckets worth of human cogitation. One of them, a quick bucket, are things that testers can do in about a second or less. You can look at something and decide if it's good or bad. Pass or fail, right? And we do a lot of those judgments in testing. Another bucket are things that are thoughtful. These are things that you have to sit and think about, right? Maybe 10 minutes, on the order of 10 minutes to an hour, right? You have to actually sit there and think. And then there's more other things like test strategies, and we'll talk about these things. There's another set of stuff that you know we have to go out and talk to our product managers, talk to our customers. We realize and we rely on all of our experience in all the previous project delays and bugs we've seen in our life to make predictions about the future. And build strategic kind of things. So that's another bucket. Say things that are on the order of a day. You can build a test strategy in a day or two or three. So the quick examples, quick examples. of things that take less than a second or on the order of a minute are things like regression automation checks, right? Like we get to, whether human or manual, we get to a point in the app and is that working as expected or not? That's a quick judgment call, right? Things like just diffs. So if I have two UIs, are they different or not, right? And not just are they different pixel-wise, but are they kind of look similar, right, serving the same function, like a more of a meta view of diffing an application's behavior or UI. And then lastly is performance, right? How fast is the app, and is that good enough or not? Sometimes it takes a couple seconds to go, it's slow, but we can ship. So the middle set of things that we do as testers are things like test generation. This is where things we take a lot of pride in, that we can create a test case from scratch. Out of the ether of the universe, we can write a test case, right? Ironically, someone else has probably already thought of it, but that's another story. We do usability, right? We go, would an average human be able to figure out what to do on this screen or this page, right? Okay, cool, good. I was actually trying to figure out if the countdown clock is counting up or down. We're good. And that, by the way, took 2 seconds worth of compute, because, yeah, I'm running a 386 SX. So, that aged me. So, what about negative and edge cases, right? You have to think about and understand the actual behavior, and then think, how am I going to break that? Where is it going to break? Have to some understanding of how it might have been implemented. And then obviously security is a similar thing. How do we work around, how do we be smarter than the developer? How do we be smarter about what different conditions it might be under, especially under attack? We have to model the attacker and model the software that's being tested. But these things you can do in out of 10 minutes or an hour kind of thing. And then lastly, the most complex things we do as testers are things like test strategy and planning. Right? How many people do I need? How many machines do I need? How do I convince product management and development that I've done enough work, pre-work, so that when the bug happens in production, I can blame them because they agreed with my test strategy? Exploratory testing, right? Everyone's very proud that they can look at an app they've never seen, verify that it works intelligently. And then lastly, the ultimate thing, we debate whether testers should do it or not, which is, should we ship to production or not, right? Some people argue that testers should make that decision. Some people argue it should be product management or development. I don't care. There's at the end of the day, a human makes that decision, and it's usually a quality-based decision. But these are things that require, you know, hours of thinking, sometimes days, and often require either multiple people to make that decision, or at least the tester's mind making that decision has to have the empathy to understand the product managers and developers and customers that they're going to impact. So, boom, there we go, sorry. So all I did was really, really smart. I took about 40 minutes with a latte, and I just put these things in order on top of Kurzweil's graph. So don't blame me, blame Kurzweil, a guy who's a lot smarter than me. And I just put those on this rough timeline here. But there's a lot of things in here. What this means is the rough timeline of when different testing activities will probably be subsumed by AI. Right? And it's the first time I think I've seen, I know I just say like, I don't know, someday, right? But I was asked to talk on this topic and I thought I better figure it out. So this is the best I could do. But if you look at it, these things are already happening today. It wasn't on purpose. If you look down in the quick decisions, so like things in the current timeline out through maybe 2024, 25, guess what they happen to be? They're things like automation regression, right? Things we saw at the beginning on the second slide. There are things like performance analysis, which those AI bots can also do. And you also look at things like, look in the industry. What are we doing in terms of AI and visual testing today, right? You've got companies like Apple Tools. I got another dollar. Every time I say Apple Tools, I get a buck, buck and a half. But Apple Tools is doing visual diff, and other folks are doing visual diff, like Retest and some other ones. But why are they doing that now? It's because the compute is just at the point where we can start to apply the machines to these testing problems. Right? When you go out in the expo, there's no testing companies saying, hey, we automatically generate your test strategies with an AI, right? Well, why not? Because it requires a lot more computation, and we're not there yet. But the beautiful thing here is you can see this progression over the next few years, and basically the net is, you know, probably by the year 2025, there won't be a whole lot of test automation engineering going on. There won't be a lot of Python coding, right, to do step by step by step and tell the machine exactly what to do step after step. There probably won't be a lot of performance analysis done by humans. There probably won't be a lot of visual diffing done by humans. Guess what the humans will be doing? Still generating test cases, right? Doing some security testing, empathizing with the user, finding out what, trying to a proxy for the user and say, ah, that would be confusing for the average person, right? Those are things that will still be available to testing. And so the number of talks at this conference will probably be more. There'll be more testers, but they'll be focused on fewer things. And then lastly, if you look in the kind of timeline of 2029, 2031, what's going to go? A lot of the things that we think humans, only humans can do today. Test strategy will actually be starting to be done by machines, right? Exploratory testing will start to be done by machines. And lastly, the machines will decide whether we ship or not. Not our developer, not our PM, and not us. And the crazy thing about AI, if you think about it, is that AI can actually look at every software project that's been executed. We've only had a limited experience of a few apps or a few teams or a few companies, but the machines learn from all projects they're exposed to. So it's almost manifest destiny that these things will just make better decisions than humans. And so sometime in the early 2031s, two magical things happen, right? One is that there won't be a need for software testers. Carbon-based software testing will be best left to the machines, right? It's best if we sleep at the wheel or we're in the back seat and let the machines do most of the testing. More importantly, I just made this up this morning, but that's also the year that I plan to retire. So when I'm wrong, I'll admit it from the Bahamas or something like that. So that's the big money slide there, right? And that answers a lot of, should answer a lot of questions. I think it's the best approximation I've seen today. And that's not bad, right, for your money. You figured out when the machines are going to take over, what order they're going to take stuff over, and the big lesson for you to take away from this is where you should be on this curve, right? If you're doing a lot of performance engineering, probably want to think about test planning, right? If you're doing a lot of regression automation, maybe get better and smarter at exploratory testing to keep your careers ahead of the AI curve. So the next question is, well, how are we going to get there, right? Yeah, it's easy to draw a couple plots and bloviate and all this stuff, but how are we going to get there? And I want to show you the things that are happening now. These are real, this is real AI, real machine learning, and applied to software testing. So first thing we do is teach them to see. These things need to be able to look at the product, right? It could be the API, it could be the code, or it could be the user interface. Now we have this magical thing called the testing pyramid. I'll wake everybody up. Everybody heard of the magical testing pyramid? Wrong, apparently it's a two-dimensional triangle. Now I'm doomed, I'll never be invited back. So, but if you look at this, what this mess of boxes are, is Google launched this thing called AutoVision ML a couple of months ago, maybe 4 months ago. All I did was take a screenshot of the Facebook app, you know, screenshot of screenshots, pretty meta, but you upload them to this API, guess how much it costs? A tenth of a cent, right? For a tenth of a cent, you get all this data back, and guess what data you get back? It outlines all the boxes and text boxes, and it can identify people and cats and everything in your application. But do you know what this really looks like? Google made it so that you can find cats and dogs. Without even writing specific code to help software testers, this is an example of how AI will just subsume most of our infrastructure and testing. This looks a whole lot like Selenium to me and Appium. What does Selenium and Appium do? They tell you what's on the screen. Where it is, the X, Y, height, width, what's the text in the box, right? It even does better things than that. It'll identify pictures and tell you if Barack Obama's in the middle of the thing, right? Or if the Google logo shows up in there. This looks a whole heck of a lot like Selenium and Appium. I didn't do this. Google did this by accident. So you can imagine a few years. Why would you use Appium and Selenium? You just ask the Google API, tenth of a penny, no code. Just a quick little web call, and you get all this information back about your application. There's this, I can talk about it because it's open source, if anyone uses Selenium or Appium, and I think 85, 90% of people use one of those two things in our industry today, there's now an open source classifier, right? My team open sourced some real AI. So the training data is open sourced, the training process, the integration with Appium is already out there. So if you want to use AI in software testing today, if you want to do it, you can do it by this afternoon. If you don't want to do it, you won't do it this afternoon. If you want to hide and run and pretend it doesn't exist, that's okay. But the people that are actually curious and want to see this stuff running today can download an open source plugin and make a web call in, or a local call in their Appium to find a shopping cart with AI. It's happening today, and it's even open source. So this is where how AI started to transform, starting it's hello worlds, but this stuff is real. It's not just someday AI will do this stuff. If you download this open source plugin, it replaces this. Everybody, this looks familiar, right? I think half the money spent on testing is spent on this actual API call, right? When it breaks. You have to find these things, write them and code them, the app changes, and you gotta update and fix the damn things, right? And by the way, I learned that damn doesn't count as a swear word because it's okay for PG programming. So what do? We just get a bunch of pictures of shopping carts. It's not that hard, people. We just get a bunch of shopping carts together, train a neural network with a command line, and now what we can do? We can say, hey, driver, instead of a CSS path or an XML selector or XPath selector or CSS selector, we can say, get it by custom. We say, hey, AI, give me the shopping cart. This happens today. And your shopping cart can look like anything. It looks like almost any normal shopping cart, and it will find it. So if that shopping cart moves around, it'll still find the shopping cart. If the shopping cart changes its ID, it changes its attributes in the HTML or the underlying application DOM, it still finds the shopping cart. And you're all testers, and this is the most annoying question I ever get. What if there's two shopping carts? It returns the location of two shopping carts. So we're starting to see that AI can actually see our applications and understand what's in them and what's going on inside them. Next thing we go, and I hear all the time, I've heard a lot of times this week, I'm going like, wait till the keynote, is they need to have intent, right? People keep saying the machines don't have intent, right? I think it's too often conflated, intent conflated with consciousness, but we can give the machines intent. Here's a quick example. So people associate all exploratory testing with, I have this intent, I have this beautiful software mind, and only I could do it, a machine can never do exploratory testing. But what if we had a loop where the AI can recognize through machine classifiers, that's a weather app. And they can also identify that that's a search text box. So now you know there's a search text box on a weather app. What do we put in the text box? Yep, a location, a zip code, a city, right? Guess what the bots can do? Enter a city. Amazing, right? Very intelligent machines. So they enter a city, and we as humans can say, what happens next if they hit enter on the search? It'll either show in the UI a list of possible city completions, generally for weather apps, or we'll go straight to the city and show you the temperature today. So there'll be some degree Fahrenheit and degree centigrade somewhere on the page. So we can have a repository. The repository that we're working with today has over 3,000 predefined, human-defined, right, test cases that have these basic application features and tests for these features. And it can run in a loop, right, and just run and run and run forever on the test, on the app, semi-intelligently testing the app. But it replaces about 70, 80% of the exploratory testing I've seen humans do, right? And by the way, that's the boring part of exploratory testing, right? Do the more interesting stuff, the more creative things. Before the bots do it. So this is kind of the state of the nation. I like to just be very real about things. This is how I spend my life. And this is kind of where AI software testing bots are today. People usually think about it as AI is going to start generating those test cases, right, for us. But we know that's not true. That's not going to happen for maybe another 6 or 7 years in practice, just because of raw compute problems. But what we can do today, though, is we can take a human mind, a wonderful mind, say mine, and open a spreadsheet and take all the top applications and group them by similar functionality, right? It's boring, right? But we can do that. And you can do it on the order of thousands, even 10,000s of apps if you have enough lattes. So next, what I can do is for every category, of every cluster of applications, we can write a basic BVT suite, right? Just basic automation test cases. So this is, can I log in, right? Can I do a search? Can I find, if it's a shopping app, can I find the shopping cart? If it's a sports app, can I find current scores or live TV broadcasts of games? Those are simple tests, but they're the most important tests in terms of testing an application. We just write these things very quickly. You can see here, this is all the input that the AI bots need, is a little spreadsheet of these tests. We take that CSV file, sorry to be too nerdy, and we just process it, post-process it into a JSON file, which doesn't matter right now, but it's pretty simple. And you realize we haven't told the machines at this point anything specific about the app. They don't know any IDs. They don't know what app they're going to look at. They just know, hey, for sports scores apps, there's going to be team standings, player stats, and live scores. Now, this is the most embarrassing and coolest thing I've ever worked on. This replaces one line of Python code, right? And actually, it also replaces about 10 lines of Java. But the crazy thing here is, we don't need to go through it here, but it's the Rube Goldberg of test execution. But what this does is it can take those declarative, almost BDD cucumber-like test descriptions, pick those up, look at an app it's never seen, and execute that test case. And this works today. We use a combination of classifiers. The AI can see the app, right? We use reinforcement learning to let it train tens of thousands of times to figure out how to get from the home page to the shopping cart to the login page. This is the most complicated piece of test software ever. It's been very expensive and very painful. But AI is able to take those declarative, high-level definitions of test cases and execute them on apps it's never seen before. So what about judgments, right? Humans say, well, the computers can't tell if it's good or bad. That needs my brain. I'm special and I'm amazing, right? And only my unique experience can judge things, especially qualitative things, right? So what I did last year, dang it, you saw the answer. Or was it on purpose? If you look at this, I thought, okay, everyone's bugging me about when's AI going to take their job. So I'm realizing that my friend circle is going to dramatically shrink over time, right? And so I tried to find something. I did an experiment. I said, what's the hardest damn thing I think is going to for the machines to do? And I thought, literally myself, I thought, I'm going to find a way to keep some of my friends by saying there's a whole part of testing that AI may never get to or will take a long, long time. So I thought, what about qualitative judgments? So I looked at a popular service that does a lot of usability studies, and I looked at the hardest attribute, right? And that was trustworthiness. Like, if you asked me to look at a login page and tell you how trustworthy it was, I've been around the block testing a lot of apps. I don't know how to do it. Just think for a second yourselves. How would you do it? How would you judge how trustworthy the login page is? It's a difficult question. I gave that question to about 60 people live, and four people had an answer. Two of them had this, they each had dupes. There were only two answers. They were duped twice. One was that if it was a familiar brand, right, then people would trust it. So say if it's Google or possibly Facebook or Twitter or some other application, they would trust it, right? But if it was a brand they didn't recognize or the logo looked a little bit jank, they would be a little bit more leery, right? So all we did was ask like 1,000 people, here's a picture of screenshots for mobile apps for login pages. Rate its trustworthiness 0 to 10. We take all that data, train a neural network on it. It's actually pretty trivial. And with Google stuff, you just take the pictures and upload them to the cloud and say trustworthy or not, and it will do it for you. You don't have to code. So the other thing I found, these machines found, was that if the language matches the app store, right, it's trustworthy. It's more trustworthy. So if you're in the English US app store and you look and it's Japanese or German characters, it goes, whoa, I don't even know what's going on here, right? I may not recognize the brand. But even worse, I can't even read the terms and conditions. I can't read the warning that says, hey, we're going to eat all your information. Just click here, right? So humans have been able to come up with these two things. This is what's crazy to me. The humans were able to come up with these two attributes that might be correlated with pages and whether they're trustworthy or not. The crazy thing is, and actually, get to this real quick. We'll go back to this one. This is how the AI and the humans separated trustworthy and untrustworthy apps. So on the left-hand side, these are examples of login pages that were deemed untrustworthy or least trustworthy, right? Again, this is for the English US App Store. So very popular brands in China. Most Americans don't recognize those brands. And more importantly, they also have a high occurrence of foreign characters, right, for that language and that locale. And on the right, those are pretty trustworthy. Nike, Disney, AT&T, I'll give them my data, right? So you might have been able to sort this out manually. The question is, though, would you have actually figured out how you made those determinations, right? So the cool thing about AI is that you are making qualitative judgments independently, right, with your own experience, but the machines actually figure out how to quantify quality for the first time. They figure out how to actually understand what's making them think the way they do. You just have an intuition. So the craziest part of this little experiment was, and I realized at this point, I'm just going to have no friends. I need to befriend bots and make sure the bots like me. They're hard-coded. If user is Jason Arbon, be nice. But the other thing they found out is that the higher the number of elements on the web page, on the page, the less trustworthy it was. And if you think about that, that kind of makes sense, right? For a couple of reasons. We don't know really why that's the case, right? And the AI is only mimicking humans, but it's doing a better than a human judgment. It figured out the fewer elements on the page, the more trustworthy the app is, that login page. And why is that? We don't know. We need to do more investigation to figure out why. Maybe it's important to dig into it. Maybe it's not. But if you think about it, if there's a whole bunch of text on a page that you have to read, something's going on, right? So what happened is I cut the AI brain open, figuratively, looked in. It was looking at the same two key elements that humans decided trustworthiness. And I found out there's a third thing it's really looking at, and it's this count of the number of elements on the page. So it was fundamental to me, I didn't realize it for a few days, was that I actually learned from AI. I learned something about my profession, I've been around the block, and I didn't really know what to do with trustworthiness, and I learned from the AI. And everyone in that little class that we had, it was here last year, also learned that if you're working on a login page, it's probably better to have fewer elements on the page because your users will trust it more. But we only know that as humans today because the AI figured it out. The AI looked at a ton of data and sussed that information out. Not a single human or usability expert was able to come up with that, as far as I know today. So we've learned from machines. You know, we're walking around the hallways going, the machines, and like my Selenium code breaks all the time. I'm safe, right? But we're now already starting to learn from the machines. Another thing I have to note is that data is dangerous. Like I was explaining right now, we don't know why the AI ultimately made those decisions, right? More importantly, guess what? I only trained that trustworthiness score on people from the English, that are on Mechanical Turk, that are of a demographic that makes less than we do annually, right? A lot of them are probably based not on the coast, they're probably in the Midwest, like literally. That's the demographic of all these folks. And more importantly, we don't know why they made their decisions on trustworthiness. It could be because of some inherent bias. Maybe it's not the language. Maybe it's actually the news talking about Huawei hacking our cell towers, right? We don't know why. So there is inherent bias in that training set. More importantly, guess what? If it was a representative, even if it was a representative sample of every person in the United States, guess what? We're not all the same person. There's a lot of diversity, right? So there can be underrepresented demographic minorities or opinions, right? What about folks who live in the U.S. that don't speak English as a native, as their first language? They would trust these apps more than the average United States citizen, right? So we have to look at the data we're training, and we have to understand its impact on our users. And the real thing to note here is, it's a long, another whole topic. I'll leave it for later so that I get called back to hang out in Orlando again. But the problem is that we don't understand, and it turtles all the way down, right? But we do know that we can replicate humans with all of their frailty. So I'd like to just give a shout out to my homeboy, Michael Bolton. Might surprise a few folks. But I attended his class finally, years, decades later, on critical thinking for software testers. And I just want to say it was the first class I sat in that I thought was actually could prepare testers for this new world order. Not of how to build AI systems for testing, but there needs to be a new profession, which is testing these AI-based systems, right? And the key thing there is critical thinking. It's questioning the data, questioning the output, questioning its impact on humanity. And Bolton was he grabbed me by the collar, almost literally. I thought he was gonna beat me up, actually. And I was starting to cry, and he said, "Jason, what are those machines thinking?" And I said, "I don't know." He says, "They could be dangerous." And I go, "Maybe." But it's the best class I've ever seen for somebody to transition from functional testing to kind of testing AI. And I wish I had it before I worked at Bing on the search engine. And more importantly, it's something we have to think about when we build these AI testing systems. We need to finally really actually test our testing infrastructure if it's based on AI. We can't just, go, the Python looks pretty good, code review, and ship it. Humans can't process thousands or hundreds of thousands or millions of data points. So we need to be very careful about how we test these AI-based testing systems. So reuse. So if AI is going to test everything in the world, it needs to be able to reuse things. It can't look at every app, probably in the near term, and start from scratch, which is what we do as humans, right? We need to accelerate things. So the beautiful thing about AI is it's much like a human. It can look at an app and we don't have to tell exactly what to do. We can give it the intent. On the left-hand side is literally a thing called an AI intent test case format. It looks like BDD Cucumber, right? Which is awesome because it means that we have test definitions that are separate from the implementation of the app, and it represents the business logic. So we don't, the exact text on the left doesn't matter, but basically it's just saying, find the search box, enter the string gradient, because I was pitching to some investors to get some money to play with this a little bit more, perform a search, and then make sure that some search result thing looks like a search result pops up and says the word gradient in it. It's a pretty basic search test, right? But the crazy thing is if you look on the right, guess what happened? This is the awesomest thing ever, in my opinion. It's been the bane of software testing. That same test case executed without, first of all, it executed without having to know any app IDs, element IDs, or any of that kind of muck. No implementation details. Secondly, it ran across platform. The middle run is on Google Desktop on Chrome. The other ones are mobile apps. So now we have a way to have tell the AI and the machine to, here's the test case, but run it on multiple platforms for me. And it, if it looks like a search box, it's a search box. The bots don't care if it's mobile, desktop, web, or what have you. And the most importantly, the most crazily exciting thing here is that the same test case, just like a human, can run across applications. If you look at this, the Google app has three steps to get to a search result. The Yahoo app does it in two. Bing does it in an amazing like six or seven or something like that. And DuckDuckGo, ironically, asks you a lot of information before they give you anonymized search results. So what's happening here, though, is that an AI was able to, we were able to reuse that test case across platforms and across applications. So the AIs actually now have the advantage. Our old school Appium and Selenium and Python and Java stuff can't do that today. Only in very, very limited cases where we carefully craft it. So the last thing we need to teach these bots is to scale, right? A beautiful thing that's happened in the last few years is that machines have got a lot faster and a lot cheaper. By the way, if you noticed, I don't know if you pay attention, people think, oh, my machine's about as fast as it was 4 or 5 years ago, blame Moore's law and lousy, platform code, right? The reality is, guess what? We've seen 10 and even hundreds of times of performance increases on dedicated AI chips, right? So these general purpose processors are pretty darn slow, we know that, but we're seeing orders of magnitude increase in computation and throughput and power and decreases in power utilization for AI processes. So the next generation of hardware, guess what it's being built for? It's not being built for us, it's being built for AI. Right? And that's where the next computational leaps and bounds are going to be made. And guess what we need for this to happen? AI to get faster and cheaper. It's happening as we speak. This is a fun little screenshot I made one day. This is just a small snippet of the number of apps that the bots have been testing. Right? This actually, if I really wanted to show this, you couldn't see the full scope of all the apps it's tested. You know, these would be like only a few pixels wide. Right? But how many in here have actually tested this many applications? No one, right? I haven't, but AI has. These AI bots are actually testing at the scale, and they're testing at the scale today. So where is this going in the near future? It's not a plug because we're not selling anything, but if you go to the expo, we have something fun, I think, today. I think it's pretty fun. You can go down and play with the data and test results that came from an AI testing bot. All we have is a table set up, and you can go in there, and you can actually play with the user interface. You can pick an app, and you can look at the test case results. You can look at the performance, and you can play with all the user flows that happened while the AI was testing the app. And the cool thing that happens with scale is that you can benchmark your app against other applications, right? So only the most expensive, elite, rich apps on the planet can afford to test their competitors. With AI, this is going to democratize this sort of benchmarking to everyone. So if you work at this shopping app, you can benchmark yourself automatically against Walmart and Target because the AIs just ran the same test case on the other applications. So you can see things like, hey, is my user flow really horrible? And I'll pick on Target because I think someone from Target's here. And he said they're a $1 billion app and no one cares about testing. And it's kind of true because they have the worst login experience on the planet. But I didn't know it until I compared. I said, hey, I did a query, who's got the worst login experience on the planet in shopping? And guess what showed up? Target. And why was Target suck? To log in, you bounce out to a browser and back in, and there's permission dialogues. And all I want to do is get in the app and buy something, right? But Walmart does it in about 4 or 5 steps, I think. Amazon, you can do it technically in like 4 steps. So you can look at not only like are they performance pound per page load time, but from a user experience level, I can do crazy queries to understand usability and user experience issues, right? But it's only because we have the power and scale of AI. So we need feedback. You guys are test nerds, you know this stuff. Please drop by our booth and just play with it and click a few buttons and give us some feedback on how this data might be useful to the community. And in context, I have a Robinhood business model. To be clear, I'm trying to steal from the people that have all the money, which are the big companies that have $100 billion plus, recently repatriated from Europe, boom, and they don't know what to do with it. But then a lot of our data exhaust we're going to share with the community, right? And we'll soon be opening this up so people can actually test their own apps with AI without having to write any AI. But anyway, this data is coming, it's real, and it's happening now. So back to the singularity, right? What does this all mean? If you want to stay a tester, this is the track you need to keep your career on. You need to be ahead of the curve of where the bots are probably going to be over the next decade or two, right? So if you're doing performance testing, A/B testing, visual testing manually, or test automation, you might want to look further down or further up, better probably way to put it, up the curve here. And then secondly, again, remember, I will be right until I'm proven wrong. I'm saying it's going to happen, and this thing might slide to the right a little bit, depending on compute, depending on the talent in this room, if we adopt AI for testing tools and solutions. Again, I'll retire before I'm wrong. That's not actually true. I can't stop. So lastly, if you want to keep ahead of this curve and understand what's going on in the industry and with regarding to AI and software testing, there's a little website. Sometimes people think it's a giant organization. It's Tariq and I started it because we were lonely. And if you enter your email address, I have a Squarespace form that sends you updates. As soon as we find some cool papers and innovation, we see these things happening, we're sharing them out with the community. And if you have progress, and the cool thing is this is the first year I've come here, and more than 2 or 3 other people have actually been experimenting with machine learning and AI on their own testing problems, right? And the questions I've heard from people are not, how does AI work? But this year it's, I've got a specific business problem for testing or quality. How can I apply testing to that specific problem? And that means that next year, a lot of the conversations are going to be around, hey, I've got AI and machine learning testing my app in a baby form, a hello world form, but how can I scale it? How can I make it more efficient, right? How can I share it with other people? So we're seeing over just the last 3 years, like a lot of progress in this space. Again, I was kind of a sole nut job a few years ago. Now there's a lot more nut jobs. But if you look at, I'll bet if we plot the number Mike, maybe we should do this, plot the number presentations on the AI and machine learning track at these conferences, it's probably going up exponentially. It probably went from one to two to four to eight, and maybe it's 16 next year, right? But again, this is the exponential growth. It's happening whether we like it or not. So I'd like to conclude by just saying, don't shoot me, I'm just the messenger, right? That was my original plan. But then I realized, I'm working on AI and building test bots. So maybe, I don't know, maybe you should shoot me. But anyway, thanks for listening, and that's not bad for the morning, right? The future of software testing by AI, and we know when and how it's gonna happen. So anyway, thank you.
Okay, just take a minute to let that sink in, huh? Wow, thanks, Jason. That was eye-opening. Difficult for me to keep up in summarizing, but I'll try to do it some justice. Testing all apps for all people, quite a vision, right? In the future, AI's auto control twice as safe in a couple years. Interesting. We have a moral obligation to turn over control to bots. Very thought-provoking. Machines go beyond checking, now creating. And then I love the testing buckets. The quick, 2023-ish, the thoughtful 2027-ish, and the contextual 2031-ish, right? But yet data is dangerous, AI bias. And then a very powerful point, testers must learn to think critically about AI-based testing systems and infrastructure. AI has an advantage in cross-platform testing today. AI is testing apps at scale today, right? Oh, and Jason has a Robin Hood business model. Love that, all right? Trying to wrap my head around all that, carbon-based software testing best left to the machine over the next decade. So very important to think about moving away from what Jason categorized as quick and thinking about continuing to reskill ourselves into the thoughtful and contextual dimension. Jason, thank you once again. All right, we have a break, and then we're going to move into our concurrent sessions, lunch, expo is open. Don't forget to join us back here for the closing keynote, some wrap-up, and the encore session. Enjoy your day.
All right, and that wraps up our first event of the day. We'll be back here in about half an hour with an industry technical presentation, Agile versus DevOps for continuous testing, how to optimize your pipeline. In the meantime, if you'd like to switch over to the interviews tab, we've got an interview starting in just a minute. Thanks for joining us.